are the Orcs, and we have a plan.
To watch all of Ron Moore's Battlestar Galactica.
And drink beer.
Hello, friends!
Hello!
Welcome to Borgcast Galactica 4.5. It feels like ages since the last one, doesn't it? Is there anything we're going back to one a month? Yes, if it feels like you have to wait ages for the next episode. But hey-ho, because Picard is on at the moment,
yep.
This keeps us sane. Anyway, our first of tonight's episodes is Flight of the Phoenix.
Yeah.
Roger, Blue Leader, safe fuel state.
What the hell is that?
It was us, sir, but I can't find the source of the transmission.
Something's triggering our comm system to broadcast an automatic signal.
Which the Cylons could trace to get a fix on our position.
Let's assume that for now. Update and distribute emergency jump sites just in case they show up again. D, get me a...
Which was named after a 1965 war film starring James Stewart, where a group of pilots are stranded in a desert and have to build a plane using scavenged parts.
So oh, well,
you can see why they went with that, can't you?
Yeah.
Originally, apparently, the concept was just based around Tyrrell building his ship, and it was going to be completely set in the hangar bay.
All right.
I'm not sure the entire episode would have been sustained by that, personally, but there we go.
No. You can see a Cylon, massive Cylon fleet.
Always a good start to an episode, loads of spaceships, yep. Although the weird belching noise is strange.
Weird belch.
What the hell is that all about?
I don't know.
It's weird. I think it's some sort of Tibetan thing, but it's just odd. Why?
I don't know.
There are quite a few odd musical choices in both this and the next episode.
And then you have the Chief being all sensual with a Viper in a really weird way.
Mm.
And then he just pulls its guts out and says it's fit only for scrap. You have Callie getting out of jail and everyone celebrating and a load of people saying he should have been given a medal, not locked up.
Mm-hmm.
Which kind of sets the tone for the attitude towards the Cylons for this and the next episode. And then Hilo and the Chief have a face-off followed by a punch-up, Rhys Sharon. And then you find out that Galactica is transmitting an automated signal that's going to allow the Cylons to home in on them, and all their equipment is on the fritz.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually a really long teaser.
Yes, and a series of people losing their rag, basically.
Yeah, lots of shouty-shouty. So the survivor count is 47,853, which is the same as before.
Yep, final cut, yep.
And then you have Dee, who's been knocked down, presumably by the really horrible loud noise. It presumably messed with her head and made her...
Well, her whole console exploded.
And then you get Ty going, fix it. And you get Gator going, yeah, but to do that, I've got to go look through every line of code. That's just ridiculous. And Ty's like, I don't care, fix it. Which is kind of a common military thing to say. I mean, I'm not saying it's not unreasonable, but that sort of thing does happen with a commanding officer just basically going, I don't care about the details, just fix it. And Gator just goes, you know, it's not an excuse. It's just fracking facts. And sort of loses it, basically, and Adama's like, yeah, sort yourself out, mate. And then Apollo comes down to see Tyrrell, says he wants his ship, and Tyrrell's like, no. And Apollo's like, I want my ship. And he's like, yeah, no, it's scrap.
Broken.
Yeah, what do you want me to do? And then Apollo's like, well, only your best. And then Tyrrell's just sort of like, maybe that's the problem. So he has a new project. He's going to make a new fighter. And everyone's like, yeah, right. And he says, you know, it's got to be sort of on your own time, and no one steps up because they all just think it's impossible and ridiculous. And then you have Roslin with Doc Cottle looking at her medical files.
Yeah, the look on Cottle's face says it all, really, doesn't it?
Does. She's got weeks, maybe a month at the outside to live. And then you've got Starbuck and Apollo and Hot Dog on the firing range. And they start giggling, and then Hot Dog falls over, and basically there's too much nitrogen, not enough oxygen, i.e. creates laughing gas. But it's because the oxygen is on the fritz, and this is all part of the Cylon virus.
I think that's a really good scene. I mean, yeah. It's really, you know, you think, yeah, they're going to kill them off.
Yeah. What I don't quite understand is what's happening is, because they shoot, don't they, at the window.
Mm.
Are they successful, or is it that someone breaks
the door? Yeah, no, they are successful eventually, but it takes a few shots to break the glass, so...
And it turns out that the Cylon virus learns as it goes. And it's described as heuristic, which is a word I've heard before. But is it made up? Is it a
No, word? It means allowing someone or something to learn for themselves.
Okay.
So it's basically describing the way in which it's learning from their systems.
Fair enough.
I had to Google it, by the way. I didn't know that beforehand.
Right, fair enough, fair enough. Apollo and Dee fighting. So it looks as though Apollo's running some kind of class.
Yeah.
Because there's other people there as well. But there's clear chemistry between Apollo and Dee.
Yeah, it's not the first time we've had this, is it?
No. Yes, and then it's like, oh, yeah, hello, Billy. It's yes. Just like, oh. You know, hey, Lee, choose someone and stick with them.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on? What's happening? And it's like very much a case of, this is the Cylon virus. It is going to kill us all. And then you have the chief with his still, and he pretends it's solvent. Ty comes in, and you know, you can't lie about alcohol to Ty. Come
exactly,
on.
He says, I know the smell of a still when I smell it. It's like, I bet you do.
Yeah. And then the chief is just kind of like, you've got to give me this, I've got to have something. And actually, give him his due, Ty understands this. Yeah. And he's like, well, actually, I did say I was going to do so-and-so a favour by offloading the engines that he doesn't want off of his ship. And it's like, oh, right. And then, so Ty's kind of nice, but then he takes some of the alcohol as payment, which I kind of like, really. And then you're looking at, with Galactica Systems, the only solution that Baltar and Gaius can say is you've got to go for a cold restart. It's the only way to get rid of it. Get rid of the virus. Basically, I think you have to put it in safe mode and then restart from a backup. But they're thinking of getting Sharon's help, which you find out because Roslyn comes to see Adama and she looks at him, she goes, what's wrong? So he tells her what's wrong. And she's like, I'm not really sure what I could do other than give you moral support. And he's like, no, I need your advice. Should I be trusting this Cylon? And then she says, well, look, at the end of the day, we created them. Is there common ground? So he appears, and then you see Sharon going up onto the bridge, surrounded by armed guards, and she's got like a neck thing as well as...
Unpleasant.
Yeah, very unpleasant, as well as she's hobbled and she's on handcuffs. And they're like, right, let her go. She says to Dee, do you still carry your father's pocket knife? And Dee looks completely freaked out, but passes, you know, it gets passed over. And then she digs into her own skin and then she asks for some kind of cable and uses a knife to...
Optical cable, yes.
To shear it off and puts it in her own skin and plugs it into herself in a way that's really gross. And you can see everybody on the bridge is totally grossed out by...
Yeah, although if she's able to do that, then her biology can't be exactly the same as a human being, so therefore they should be able to tell the difference between humans and Cylons. Because clearly they've got some sort of connectors up inside themselves, so...
Yes, and I mean, it depends. I mean, my thinking was, what if it's... Because she's fiddling around for quite some time. I mean, before she finds it, is it, for example, in the bone marrow or something? Do you know what I mean? Is it that hidden and that masked...
You'd still be able to see it with an X-ray, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but have they actually... I suppose you could argue, have they tried X-raying the Cylons? I don't know.
Oh, they must have done, surely, because they're going to... You know, they've post-mortemed at least a couple, haven't they? So
I can only think that it's just... It's not something that obviously...
Because up till now, it's like they are identical with human beings, and now suddenly it's like, no, they're not, because they can do this. They've got some sort of thing inside their, you know, arms.
Well, we knew that there were certain things they could do, like download their consciousness and stuff.
Yeah, but that doesn't necessarily require any hardware, basically.
Well, you don't know, do you? I mean, I always presumed that we have bioelectrical impulses carried around by certain things, and they have the same, it's just that they're more obviously mechanical. I mean, like you say, unless they've got some kind of cloaking mechanism deliberately as part of who they are as Cylons that makes them appear to be human whenever you scan them.
Doubt it.
I don't know. But anyway, this is sufficiently futuristic, let's be honest. Like, it's not reality, darling. Do you know what I mean? Turns out that just as the massive, massive fleet is coming along and going to attack them, Sharon transmits a signal and shuts them all down. And they're all just sort of floating, at which point the Vipers then just let rip and kill a load of them and end up...
Yeah, and we discover that there are definitely organic components of heavy Vipers because they bleed.
Yeah. And then, even though she's just really massively helped out...
Saved their asses.
And saved their asses, you just get to take that thing back to its cell. And that just... Yeah. I found that really harsh.
Mm. But then again, he was shot in the stomach by one. So.
Yeah, but she's just saved his ass. I mean, I don't have a problem with the idea she goes back to her cell. Because they still, you know, it is a time of war. They still don't know enough about her. But just calling her a thing. I mean, I'm guessing it's a reaction to the fact that they just watched her stick her... Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, maybe.
But even so, he ought to have said, take her back to herself. Anyway, it just really stuck out to me. And then you get, from various points throughout the episode, you've had people eventually helping out with the ship because they can see that actually it might come to be something. And Hilo is one who, because they're lamenting the lack of metal, and Hilo is the one that comes up with the idea of carbon fibre. And so they end up creating a stealth ship, which they call the Blackbird. And Starbuck has already volunteered to fly it back earlier on the firing range, just because it's like, oh, no one's going to fly the chief ship. And she's like, yeah, I will. And there's a slight panic of like, shit, where's she gone? And she points out, you know, well, of course you can't see me. I am in a stealth ship, which I like. And yeah, it's generally known as the Blackbird. And they have the president come and see it and christen it. And it's called Laura, which she finds really moving and chokes up. And then she's going to smash the bottle over it like you would expect with a ship or something.
Well, she isn't going to, but she makes out like she's going to, yeah.
And then the thing is, though, she says joking.
Yeah.
And then and she sees everybody's reactions. Then Adama and Ty look at each other as if to say she wasn't joking. She was going to do that until she saw our faces. Tyrell then goes to visit Sharon. You don't hear any of their conversation, but they both pick up the phones. So, overall, I like this episode. I do like the whole Blackbird thing.
It's a good design, isn't it? It looks cobbled together.
Yes, it looks cobbled together, but you get that it works as well. Yeah.
Particularly the cockpit, which seems to be lined with silver
it
paper.
It does, yes. Tin foil. Big liners or something.
Yeah. And you compare that to the Delta Flyer in Voyager, which they managed to knock up, which looked spivvier than any shuttle they'd had up till that point. It was like, really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, but you know, it's a cool idea, and I like as well that people are sniffy with Hilo earlier, and then they're like, yeah, no, that carbon fibre thing, that was a good idea, respect, and they're sort of shaking hands with him and stuff and accepting him, which is good. So I like that aspect, even though it's really turns my stomach. I do like the whole thing about the Cylon fleet are going to attack, and then Sharon's like, no, and the common ground was her survival. Because she was saying as well that, you know, I'm a mistake. As far as they're concerned, my baby is a mistake. They're not going to save me. I'm dying and all. So I like that is the other plot running alongside it. But as I said, I don't... It just makes Adama seem really, really ungrateful after she's just clearly put herself through pain, and then she has killed a whole load of her own people. And Adama just goes, take that thing away. That's just too harsh. I'm not saying it's unrealistic, but to be honest, it's more the sort of comment I would expect to come out of Ty's mouth than Adama's. Do you know what I mean? For me, that was what got me. But I think my favourite scene is actually Ty in the still, where you just see, I just love, what's his name? Ty's actor. Somebody Hogan, isn't it?
Yes, Michael Hogan.
Anyway, I just love his performance in that scene, because you see that when Tyrell says, no, don't take this away from me, it's all I've got, you see in his face sort of the flash of horror and the recognition, do you know what I mean, and in his performance. And then he doesn't just go, oh, I understand, I'll help you out, in a way that might potentially be patronising. He gives Tyrell his dignity and says, you know, oh, I've been speaking to an XO on another ship and we could do with helping them out. Do you know what I mean? I like the performance, and I like the way that he does it. For me, that's the standout moment.
I mean, I like the fact it starts pretty grim and everything's going wrong for everybody. Everybody's falling out with one another. And by the end of it, it's actually, for BSG, it's quite an upbeat ending, isn't it?
Yeah. So. Yeah. Yeah.
And the moment where they reveal that they've named the ship after Laura, and the look on her face, I mean... Wonderful bit of acting there.
Yes, that is amazing acting, and yeah, she's clearly moved. I think the other thing I like, not so much in terms of the way it's played, don't get me wrong, it's not played badly, it doesn't stand out to me, but in terms of the writing, they absolutely at some point had to deal with Hilo and Tyrell.
Yes.
And I'm glad they didn't leave it too long before they did.
We've heard from Dory. I quite enjoyed this. Fairly good realism with them all getting antsy because they're stuck on Galactica. The Chief seemed particularly good in this one due to him building the Blackbird. Leodan was his usual greeting-faced self. Okay. Starbuck is confusing me a wee bit at the moment. Number 8 was a great help with the Cylon virus. I couldn't help wondering if the Viper's attack at the end was genocide. Yeah, I mean, Rumble describes it as a duck shoot, because, you know, they're not firing back or anything, but they just go for it.
Yeah.
Which does happen in war, sadly.
I'm not sure it's genocide, because we have no indication at any point that this is the entire fleet, mm-hmm. if you see what I mean. But it is a massacre.
Mm.
And that would be a good way of phrasing it.
Yeah, yeah, they're effectively shooting unarmed.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I say people, of course, they don't recognise them as people.
So no, but they are.
That's kind of a running theme, which will bleed into the next episode as well.
But it's quite common for soldiers to not recognise the other side as people.
Mm.
And imagine for a moment this was a human versus human war. If the other side was suddenly helpless, it would be considered immoral for those with guns to use them. But they don't try and capture, they don't just leave it, they kill them, and it would be considered a massacre. We've heard from Sampo and Yonna. This is a bit of a strange one. On one hand, quite a lot happens in this episode, including some major plot points, but for some reason it feels like a filler. The theme of the episode seems to be that morale is breaking down, which is fair enough. Actually surprised it hasn't happened earlier.
Mm.
Also, it appears that no one gets into trouble for fighting anymore, because several break out during this episode without any visible repercussions. Also, Hilo appears to be in the doghouse, but quite understandably. Speaking of machine lovers, we have a very creepy scene with Tyrell fondling a viper.
Yes, and thinking of Sharon.
Is it going through his head that if Sharon was a machine, maybe any machine will do? Ooh. And now I've gone all Jason Donovan. Instead of any dream will do, any machine will do.
Right.
I close my eyes.
All right. No. No. Just no. Socket's a socket.
Is that our episode title?
It might be.
Oh. He says, luckily, before he finds a hole to penetrate, he marks it as scrap. I would almost get excited that the Viper count goes down by one, but it goes up by one at the end of the episode, so never mind. Yonna looked at it from the point of view that Sharon, also a machine, can just be discarded, but a Viper can be built anew. But still, Tyrell can't apparently bring himself to, at least consciously, to love Sharon a machine, although he clearly has a man crush on Vipers. But what if he could fix Sharon somehow? Would he view her differently? Food for thought. The feel-good story of the episode is Tyrell starting to build a new Viper and the whole crew slowly getting behind him. While it's nice enough, I have a few problems with it. First of all, how quickly did he build it? It feels like just one or two days, which seems way too fast. First, I assumed this episode took 2 weeks, and then I realised it can't because Roslyn heard she only has weeks to live at the start of the episode. Secondly, it all feels a bit too easy how everyone is suddenly in good spirits. Even Hilo's welcome back to the fold for no apparent reason, other than he had one good idea regarding the Viper. I know everything doesn't need to be grimdark, but that felt a bit too undeserved. I don't know.
I think, particularly considering what's coming next, we needed a lighter moment. So.
We did, but also you've got to remember that Hilo is a pilot. He was part of the crew. And part of me kind of thinks that one of the reasons they were so against him before is because they felt betrayed by him. And actually, they were kind of looking for an opportunity to welcome him back. You've got to think their numbers are way down. You know, like in that documentary one, you know, there is no relief. There is no one else coming. Do you know what I mean? So I think in a way, a lot, not necessarily all of them, but some of them at least, I think, were waiting for an opportunity and an excuse for it to be okay. The second major plotline is the Cylon virus still wreaking havoc. In addition to giving us a very grumpy Gator, it culminates in Adama taking a leap of faith and trusting Sharon. She's able to broadcast Cylon virus to a fleet of approaching raiders by slicing open her artery and pushing him some fibre optic cable. Okay, and also, ew! If the humanoid Cylons are otherwise near indistinguishable from humans, I suggest looking for a USB port.
Yeah, that was kind of my point. Yeah.
Yeah. Although, I guess the other thing, though, is let's suppose for now that they had some kind of shielding in place that means that you couldn't see it. Now that they know, could they use the fact they know to find it? Do you see what I mean? It's like,
well, I mean, they've done post-mortems. They would have discovered anything that wasn't human, basically. The whole idea was they were exactly the same as us, but except clearly they're not. I mean, that's the problem.
Yeah. Also, did the printed code activate something in Sharon? Because while she's reading it, she seems to freeze for a few seconds.
It does look, I thought that for a minute as well. Yeah, and I think you're supposed to initially think that. And it's like, oh my gosh, what's she going to do now? But it was actually kind of just the shock of realising the situation she was in.
Or did she somehow contract the virus by reading the code? I'm not sure I'm looking too much into it.
I don't think so.
The Colonials get a morale-boosting victory, but to be fair, gunning down hundreds of helpless enemies doesn't feel like a grand victory. It pretty well mirrors the way the Cylons won the war. So all in all, this episode was kind of just there. Not bad, but maybe a bit all over the place. And it's telling that the most me and Yona discussed about this episode was that what if their papers, photos and even videos have cut edges? Why are all the paintings on their wall square-shaped?
Quite, yeah. Thank you. We've heard from Jeff. Wow, everyone is having a terrible time in this episode. Even previously cool and collected Gator has a well-deserved outburst. Of course, it seems Chief Tyrrell is especially miserable, but who can blame him? I can definitely identify with his solution, just being busy with your hands trying to do something productive. Careful. It was pretty moving how his optimistic act became contagious and everyone was pitching in. Even crusty old Colonel Ty got in on it. Fortunately, they have a humanoid antivirus system handy. That interface system seems pretty painful, though, but best not to consider where the most convenient USB port could be located. Again, we'll go to a Red Dwarf thing. Try as hard as I can, I just can't make the socket stay in. I was a little taken back at the Viper pilot's glee while slaughtering the helpless raiders, but there may just have been giddy relief after facing certain death. Well, yeah, that and the fact they faced genocide as well. The Blackbird is pretty cool, even if a little boxy and homespun looking. Well, kind of needs to be, doesn't it?
It does, yes.
Big Brother alert. After watching this episode, I've been getting a lot of online ads for a model of the Blackbird. I guess someone was listening. Okay.
What did Parry make of this?
Hello, Orgs. Parry here to talk about Flight of the Phoenix. I really enjoyed this one. Interesting episode. I actually think it's a bit like a very grim, dark version of In the Cards. Obviously, this doesn't involve a comedy subplot of someone trying to get a baseball card off of a crazy inventor. But there is this idea of the crew being in a hopeless state. So arguments are beginning to happen. People are poking at each other. We've got things like there's that scene between Tyrrell and Agathon and Hilo, where they're kind of Hilo's been ostracised because he's of his relationship with Boomer, and Tyrrell's similarly depressed just because there's an alive Boomer there. I mean, if you can imagine, you loved someone and you see them die, and then they're back, but they're in love with someone else. I mean, that's a hell of a lot for him to process. And he's not really processing it well. The crew are snapping, and there is even... Rosalind actually also has her diagnosis. She's not got much time left. And there is that scene between, when Gaeta snaps at... Because, of course, the other thing is the ship's still being affected by Cylon viruses. Gaeta snaps at Ty, and basically... Adama says, for all that we could have had, we've got some sort of hope from them having a direction to Earth. They don't know how far it is or how long it'll take. And there is this idea of everyone's kind of, no, this isn't going to be over soon. This is it now. This is your life. For those pilots, life is a constant. You're on duty, you're off duty. There's no weekends, there's no shore leave. And it's beginning to get people a bit down. And I really liked it. We got that. That was kind of really built in. One of the scenes that I absolutely loved in this is the scene between Rosalind and Adama. So Rosalind's had her diagnosis. She knows she's not got long. And she gives him the book back. And it's just at that point where Adama... I keep going on about how good an actor Eddie Olmos is, but just this sort of slight change in expression, and he suddenly realises the reason why she's giving the book back. And it's like she's not told him that she's not got long left, but she doesn't have to because of that gesture. And there's a certain hint of sadness and regret in his eyes, and it's, for he just does so much with so little, it's really quite amazing. Of course, the idea is Chief, to give himself something to do, starts trying to build a Viper. And indeed, it's kind of illustrated with that Viper he has to basically say is beyond repair. And I loved the way it kind of built up. So it starts off with just him doing it on his own. And people say, you can't build a Viper out of parts that we've got lying around. That's ridiculous. And then you've got the scene with the guy who says, come on, Chief, that wing's a two-man lift. You need me to help. So he helps, and before you know it, everyone's involved. And it does give you, again, what Galactica as well, is these slight light moments. So the scene after the test flight, when we've sorted out the Cylon, and indeed we also have a slight I find it hard to actually find it a fist pump moment. So you do have them bringing Boomer into CNC and sending her own version of the Cylon virus. They fix the ship by switching it on and off again, which is sensible enough, and restoring it from the backups. Presumably, you know, the Colonial OS Disk 1 is there, and you know, they've got to fill in the registration equipment information again. The massacre, for all that it's got a lot of cheering and whooping, I do actually find it a bit weird. I think I've come to see the Cylon Raiders as alive, and it does feel a lot more like a massacre. And indeed, there, you can see a bit of that with Boomer, in that she's had to do this, but she's not feeling good about it. But you also have Tyrell when the thing's finished. I love that scene where it's had the Blackbird's had its maiden flight, and you've got everyone who worked on it signing it. I thought it was a lovely touch. And then they name it after Laura, and we get the bagpipe music that I like, again, put me in the pro bagpipe music camp. Sorry to live up to stereotype. And it is just a lovely scene. And again, it's where it does that. It's not necessarily big, happy, fun, joy scenes. It's just a bit of yeah, that's nice. And you get a bit of a smile to you. And Galactica does that really well to offset the otherwise relentless darkness. So yeah, solid episode. But we're leading up to something big in the next one. So I'll be back to talk about Pegasus. I can't imagine what Pegasus will mean. But until that time, bye for now.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're right with Eddie Olmos's acting, that when she gives the book back and there is just a look between them and he knows why the book is coming back. Mm. And you just see it in his portrayal, and it's, yeah. And it's sad. And then the next thing you know, it's kind of like, well, we're all going to fucking die anyway.
I don't naturally compare this with In the Cards, because In the Cards is such a jolly light episode, and this isn't jolly or light. I mean, it's got an upbeat ending, you can say that about it, but
yeah,
it's not jolly or light.
this series does have a very different, even where, as we'll come to in Pegasus, they do some of effectively the same episodes, the tone is just so different between the two shows. And I would argue that sometimes BSG is too dark, but sometimes the original Battlestar was too light.
Well, yes, quite a bit, really. Yeah. And too disco.
No, it's not possible to be too disco.
They proved us wrong.
No, there is no such thing as too disco.
And I think, yes, it is supposed to be a massacre. Well, as I say, Ron Moore describes it as a duck shoot, so we are supposed to feel slightly queasy about that.
Yeah, yeah.
And who knew that Pori would be pro bagpipe? Wow, that's a surprise. Anyway.
Who else have we heard from?
Drew and Tracy.
So that was Flight of the Phoenix.
Yes.
What do we think of that one then?
Yeah, not bad at all, actually.
That's quite exciting.
Yep, after a couple of not exciting ones. I was
a bit lame ones, yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Let's go through some points.
Yeah.
So Hilo's back on Galactica.
Yes.
And walks into the mess hall.
Yes.
For want of a better word. So no one's met him before? No one knows him?
Just trying to think where he was from.
He was from Galactica.
Yeah.
Because he worked with Starbuck, but...
Oh, no, they're all the new pilots, though, aren't they?
Oh, the newbies,
yes,
aren't they?
Yes, that's right. Hot Dog and all that.
Yeah, okay, yes. All right, so I get it now. So how rude they were to him.
Yeah, I know, that's bad.
That's just really bad.
Mm-hmm.
But then at the end, when he comes up with the idea of using the non-metal...
The carbon...
They were like, oh, it's a fantastic idea. I would be your best friend now.
I did think that was a little bit soppy right at the end. Yeah. Always start shaking your hands.
Yeah, and then he shakes with their hands. I would have been like, fuck off.
Yeah.
You just get out of my face.
He's talking about Hilo and the chief at the beginning when they had their fight. It's a bit like Jerry Springer, isn't it? Like two hillbillies having
Jerry,
a fight.
Jerry.
It's like, in all these things, they're fighting, but it's not each other that they should be fighting. It should be Sharon, shouldn't
it? Yeah, but they're just taking their frustrations. And to be fair, Hilo hasn't got the frustration because he's kind of got the girl, if you like, and she's having his baby. But
I guess
the chief has kind of lost everything that he thought was real.
Mm.
You know, Hilo knows that she's a Cylon and he doesn't really care. But for Chief, he's lost like his love. And I do feel quite sorry for him. So Starbuck, is she currently the CAG?
I think Apollo would be, wouldn't he? Apollo is, because he's now back.
But she was acting CAG because she trained all those newbies, wasn't she? But she's not acting very professional.
She never does,
Yeah, but she's all right, so she's gambling and drinking with him in the mess hall, that's fair enough. But then she lays out that woman.
Yeah.
Because she made like a sarky comment about Hilo. Was it Hilo?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's not being professional, is it?
No.
Because at the very worst, she is their superior because she's longer serving and she's a higher grade than them. So I just don't think that she's being very...
She never is professional.
Professional. And just going back to flipping... Oh, she's such... I have this real issue with Starbucks. She's such an attention seeker.
She is, yes.
In that every time she goes out in a Viper, she has to kind of, you know, not answer the comm
and
stuff
like
that and make everyone sweat it. And everyone's like, oh my God, Starbucks dead. And she did it again in this. And I was like, oh, for fuck's sake.
I thought that
sake.
As well. So all them poor people that were thinking, oh, we've built this ship and we've now killed Starbucks.
So the chief was like,
just so that she can do a joke.
My glory. And like, she's dead. I just thought, oh, it's been done too many times. Too
many
times.
Pretty terrible. I did like, though, the whole building of the ship. It was a nice kind of like side story.
Yeah,
it's good.
And you're right. They do need something to kind of keep their minds occupied because it's becoming the same old, isn't it?
Yeah, well, that's what this was about, wasn't it?
Defending virus.
They're all fed up with every day being the same.
And when Gator snapped.
Yes. Because that's not like
him. Yeah, no, not at all. That was quite... Oh, my God. And then, like, what was his name? Ty.
Yes.
Was a little bit like, Chief, what are you going to do about that? And I really thought that Adama was going to sort of say, you know, go and take 5 minutes or whatever. But when he kind of said, put yourself together.
Well, he's got to support Ty, hasn't he?
He has, but come on.
Yeah.
He's Gator. He's never gets angry, does he?
Nope.
Why the fuck has Sharon not got a baby bump?
Well, yeah, I know, because...
She must be at least
they
6 months
sex,
pregnant now.
And then she was like instantly, oh, yeah, I'm pregnant with your baby, like about 5 minutes later.
Well, no, because it kind of inferred that they'd been on that... Was
no,
it Caprica
no, I don't think so.
For a little while?
No, they hadn't been on there too long.
She's not going to know she's pregnant instantly,
very quickly got inseminated kind of thing, and now she's like a big pose, yeah.
And she's still flat as a pancake.
Yep.
I don't think that's fair.
No.
Anyway, this was better. I enjoyed
this. Yeah, I enjoyed this.
This
not bad at all. It was
so,
okay.
Bit of a cameo for Boltar tonight.
Yep, get all the Cylons attacking and the stuff
when
with Sharon and
that. Poo, poo, poo.
Yep.
For all the Raiders that were in the, all the Vipers that were in the outside the ship, I only saw four pilots.
Yes, I know. You only saw the heroes.
Ridiculous. Anyway, let's have another one.
Yep, definitely.
Enjoyed that one.
Yep.
Let's hope the next one's a good one.
Okay.
See you later. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Yeah, good point. And I made it as well when I was watching, why has she not got a bump?
Yes. And it's also obvious in the next episode as well. It's like, come on.
Yeah. This is getting silly now. It is a bit Jerry Springer with the guys fighting. You do kind of expect there to be a sort of Jerry, Jerry chant in the background. In terms of them being rude and not knowing Hilo and then suddenly it's okay... My own take on it is just that they need it. They need it to be okay, and so they make it be okay. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
In terms of their own morale? And that were they not in the circumstances that they are in, they wouldn't be that forgiving. But that's just me. That's just my take on it. And yeah, watching the building the ship, it is a morale boost, and it's something good to get round. Do you think they built that shippy on rock and roll?
Ugh, really?
Sorry, we built this.
Yeah, you're right, right.
Sorry.
But yes, Apollo is the CAG, but there was a period when he wasn't around where Starbuck was acting CAG effectively.
Yeah.
But yet she isn't professional.
No, she never has been, but then neither was Starbuck in the original.
Yeah.
And the character is supposed to be the same, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, he was a bit... Well, I think, though, that this Starbuck... is, I would say, more insubordinate, but less cheesy.
Yes, definitely less cheesy.
Yeah. What did the Llama God make of this?
Oh, yeah, so we're having a montage.
Oh, this is a nice little episode, isn't it? This is a bit more of a standalone episode than the previous one. In your feedback, you mentioned the previous episode was meant to be a kind of standalone episode, but it does very much follow on from the whole Ty being in charge debacle. So, yeah, this one does feel much more of a standalone, although in a show like Galactica, there's never going to be a standalone episode because there's always going to be threads follow through. See the Chief and Sharon and everything in this one. But really, this is a nice little character episode. The main character moment's going to the Chief and with Sharon. And starting with the Chief, he starts this episode feeling up the fighter and having memories of feeling up Sharon as well. So, clearly that's where his mind goes when he tinkers with his machine. So, based on the fact that his old girlfriend went wrong, he decides to build himself a new girlfriend, or Viper, or, yeah, that's some interesting little displacement activity there, isn't it? But this is a wonderful little storyline, with the whole crew eventually coming together to help the Chief in his project, even though most of them think he's mad for even trying to attempt it. And it's interesting because I know that in Star Trek Voyager they attempt a separate thing, building their own special shuttle, except somehow they manage to do it and it's all perfect, whereas this one actually looks like these people have limited resources, they are cobbling stuff together, and the end result does look like it's been cobbled together, but it works and it flies, and it's a testament to the spirit and the skill of the crew, and that's lovely. The fact they get the president to come and launch her, and the fact that they name it Laura, I mean, that didn't bring a tear to my eye at all. No, it brought a couple of tears to my eyes. No, it was a lovely little moment, so I love this whole storyline. The other storyline revolving around Sharon and how she has to be brought in to help when they discover that there's a Cylon virus infecting the Galactica. Oh, didn't do quite a good job there, Mr. Gator, did you? But her once again proving herself, I mean, she's already proven herself, but I guess at the same time she is one of the bad guys, so yeah, they're not going to trust her particularly, are they? But you'd think they'd start to trust her a little bit more after this episode, given that she actually turns the virus back on the Cylon fleet themselves. I mean, admittedly, she doesn't actually kill anyone, because as we know, Cylons can't die. Can they? Is there a limit to that? We don't know. But in theory, she hasn't done anything apart from losing a lot of fighters. But even so, you'd think the Galactica fleet would be a little bit forgiving, but I guess the trauma of near genocide is kind of one that's hard to get rid of. I don't know. Thankfully, I've not experienced it just quite yet. The technobiological nature of the Cylons continues to be a bit icky as well, when Sharon just slices open her palm to stick in the cable. I mean, of course, it's the palm. You always slice open the palm. No matter what you're doing, you slice open the palm. Get shot in the gut, get sliced in the palm. Yeah, that's what happens in these shows. The fact that he's able to reintegrate by just wagging a cable in there. I mean, it was in the right interface. That is one aspect that just stretches the believability of the show, given the struggle that most of us face trying to get a USB cable to connect the right way around without having to swap it around at least 3 or 4 times before it'll actually go in the hole. The fact that you can just ram a cable in, that's something. Or maybe the Cylons are just better advanced than we are. And aside from that, there's a couple of nice little character bits as well. The Chief and Hilo sort of fighting out their feelings. I think they've kind of resolved stuff and come to an interesting place now. Kara and Kat, no, they haven't resolved anything. And Lee and D, is there something going on there during that nice little sparring session? It seemed to be getting to a point, and then Billy walked in. I mean, I know that Billy and Dee aren't an item really as such, but they kind of have an off thing going, so yeah, is this somewhere we're going with Lee and Dee? But just to show how messed up everything is, the Chief goes to speak to Sharon at the end, and then what does he say to her? Who knows? Will we ever find out? I don't know. But this was definitely a nice little character episode, just to see where the characters are and to just put things in place for whatever's happening next. So yeah, I really enjoyed this one. Just the fun of the Chief building his fighter was worth seeing. But will the Chief actually get a chance to try out his new fighter? I guess we'll find out in the next episode, won't we?
Yes, our obligatory toilet scene. Love
yeah, it's funny enough, there weren't any in this episode, weren't
there? No, well, now we have one.
Now we have one.
Now we have one, so yeah. And yeah, you're right about the whole get shot in the gut and sliced in the palm. Is that a movie thing, or is it a Ron Mori thing?
I think it's a movie thing, generally.
Okay.
But, I mean, perhaps because Ron Moore wrote a lot of the Klingon. I mean, yeah, it always happened in the Klingon episode,
stuff.
Didn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, we are going to see more of the whole... You can just tell Lee and Dee.
Dee and Dee. Now they'll leave us alone. Turn off the phone.
Right.
We can give them a little theme tune, you see.
We kind of can, can't we? It's a shame that it's not D&D, but there we are.
Yeah, Lee and D. It's just, you just
and,
know.
And D are... and Billy are supposed to be an item because they went on that date, didn't they?
Yeah,
so.
Billy. This is the sort of bit that... I suppose probably the sort of thing happens in real life, but it just really fucks me off and makes me think of EastEnders.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It is a little bit, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know that it's necessarily the case that Tyrell is trying to build himself a new girlfriend. I think that's probably taking it a bit too far. I think he's just trying to do something new and constructive to occupy himself. That's my view, anyway.
Okay. We've also heard from Andrew.
It's a very great compliment in life to have something named after you. It's a very great honour, a very great show of esteem of the people who are naming the thing after you. So when the Deck Gang make this brand new spaceship and are looking at this spaceship and they think, well, it's sneaky, difficult to control and put into service from the leftover parts we had available, I know, let's name it after the president. It's a very great compliment to Laura Roslin, a very great compliment, a high honor indeed. Chief Tyrell says he was thinking about having kids with Sharon. That's not gonna happen anymore. So he builds a spaceship instead. It's the next best thing. And the spaceship Laura comes into life at the same time as the person Laura finds out just how limited her life is going to be. She's got a month to live. In a scene which is quite light on the dialogue, it's one of those things as a writer, you want to write dialogue. You want to write things for the characters to say. But with Mary McDonnell, you don't really need to write much. She can just act it. She can act the emotions on her own. She doesn't need words to express to get that across. I think a lot of directors, maybe even on this show, would have decided to have close-ups of her so you could see the reaction on her face. But obviously, in blocking this scene, they noticed that she was doing a lot with her body. She was shaking and walking around and stuff. So they kept it quite a medium or even wider shot so you could see her doing that. See her full body reacting to this news. And also kind of serves to emphasize just how isolated she is. It's just her and the doctor in this room, and he's kind of near the camera and she's just out there in the room. Nobody next to her, nobody behind her. It's just her facing this thing, which, as she's just learned, is going to claim her life. So there's this virus which has been aboard Galactica for a little while, and finally it's kicked into gear and it's started running amok and breaking things. I'm not entirely sure how this enormous Cylon raider fleet bearing down on the Galactica sits with the end of the last episode, where all the Cylons are in the cinema and they're seeing the film of Sharon on board Galactica with the knowledge that she's still pregnant. And they seem to be very interested in this. I'm not entirely sure how you square their interest in there being a child between humans and Cylons and an all-out attack on Galactica and the ragtag fleet, unless you say something like, in the midst of the attack, they were going to board Galactica and extract Sharon and then blow it up. And the plan just didn't get that far. And Sharon's invaluable help in ending this attack doesn't really earn her much in the eyes of it. I think there's something in Adama's face, a big close up of him, when she's, you know, all done and just pulling this lead out of her arm and stuff, but he still can't bring himself to not call her a thing, take this thing back to the brig. You would think that they would have learned something from the last time a Sharon was escorted under armed guard through the corridors of Galactica, that they would clear the corridors first. Presumably somebody's keeping an eye on Callie and they think that's enough. I wondered about the wisdom of all the Viper pilots shooting down all these dead raiders in space. As cathartic as it may be to shoot down all the helpless raiders, I just couldn't help but wonder if it wasn't just a waste of ammo that they could save for an actual threat if and when the Cylons turn up again. I don't know if they're able to make munitions on board the ship, but there's no more Ragnar anchorage that they can go to get resupply, so a bullet saved is a bullet earned. If that's a phrase, it's not a phrase. And same thing goes for the firing range as well. So that's Flight of the Phoenix. There's a new spaceship now. Laura Roslin has only a month to live. And Colonel Ty's found the room where they make the alcohol. So gods only know what happens next. Thank you for your kind attention. Bye-bye for now.
Bye!
Bye!
Yeah, you're right. We should be worried. Ty has found the room where they make the alcohol. I hadn't thought about that ammo thing before, but you're right. It's, you know, it is a lot of ammo for without actually taking out a threat, isn't it?
And they're going to be limited on it. So.
Yeah. Same with the ammo in the firing range. I mean, you would have thought they'd be rationing it, wouldn't they?
You think? But yes, it's good. It's kind of a surprise they didn't call the new ship Spaceship McSpaceship Face, really, isn't it?
Okay. Yeah. I do like your comment about sneaky and made up from what's left over.
Charming.
That tickled me.
Well, anyway, let's move on to a far more cheerful episode. Yeah. No, wait, let's move on to Pegasus.
Pegasus, this is Galactica Actual. Authenticate identity with recognition codes immediately.
Sir, I'm receiving colonial recognition codes. They're authentic.
Galactica, this is Pegasus Actual. Adama, is that you?
Admiral Kane. What a pleasure to hear your voice.
So, yeah, I more felt the Living Legend episode, the original Battlestar Galactica, was the best of that run, so he always wanted to make his own version.
Obviously, there's several differences, but the biggest one here is that the Kane in BSG outranks Adama, being an admiral, whereas they were both commanders in
the same rank, weren't they? And it was, what's his face? Was it Lloyd Bridges?
Yes.
Yeah.
There was a 90-minute cut, but the network insisted on an one-hour version, apparently. Weirdly, on the commentary, Moore keeps calling it the 90-minute cuts on the commentary, but it's blatantly the hour one on that, so a bit mysterious, really, but there we go. And presumably there was originally a 45-minute one that was broadcast, but we get the hour one anyway on the DVD, so... Kara is describing her plan to rescue Anders and the other Resistance fighters. The problem is it'll involve Galactica making more than 241 jumps, so Adama says no.
Yeah. Makes me think of that bit in, is it Guardians 2?
Oh, yes, with the crazy jumps that Rocket does, yes. Then there's a big signal on the Dradis, and it turns out to be the Battlestar Pegasus. And their appearance plays out under a weird choice of soft rock music. It's very odd, the music in this episode particularly. We meet Admiral Kane in a cool command room and get to see the Pegasus in all its chunky glory. Kane is played by Michelle Forbes, of course, best known to us as Ensign Row.
Yeah.
But she was also in 24, Walking Dead, Lost, and she was in one of the Hunger Games films as well.
Yes.
Notably, she carries a sidearm at all times, unlike Adama, and this gives you a clue that she's not the same sort of officer, shall we say.
No. A little bit Adam Baldwin.
Yes, slightly. The survivor count goes up by a couple of thousand, because they've got the Pegasus crew now, so that makes sense. There's a very formal landing by Kane in a Raptor, and she welcomes the Galactica crew back into the Colonial fleet. While she has drinks with Adama and Roslyn, Tyrrell is drinking with the Pegasus XO, Colonel Jack Fisk, who's quite a character.
I like him.
Yeah, you kind of do, don't you? When Roslyn realises that Kane is now in charge of the fleet, she pulls a brilliant face, which the Admiral says looks like she just shot the President's dog.
I love that.
Meanwhile, Fisk reveals Kane's previous XO was shot for not obeying her orders.
Yeah.
I mean, he then claims to be joking, but...
You know he isn't.
Yeah, and Ty knows he isn't as well. Adama claims to not be bothered about Kane taking command, but when she leaves, it's written all over his face how he feels, to be honest.
Yeah.
Again, you've got some fantastic acting in this from Eddie Olmos. Starbuck has a go at one of the Pegasus' pilots for keeping a score of his kills on the side of his ship, which is obviously a thing in real life as well.
Yeah.
And then we meet the Pegasus CAG, who's Captain Cole Taylor, a.k.a. Stinger. He's played by John Piper Ferguson, who played a completely different character in Caprica, which seems to happen a lot. Did not expect people to watch both the series. He was also in The Next Generation, though, more importantly. Playing one of the Hollander brothers in Fistful of Datas. As in the bad guys before they were all replaced by Data.
Okay.
He's also in Unforgiven, another Western.
Oh, no, I've seen that.
Drive, which we've seen as well.
Have we?
Yes.
Okay.
X-Men Last Stand, which
we
don't talk about. X-Files, Lost, and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And obviously, he's just not a nice man.
No.
In common with many of the people on the Pegasus.
Yeah.
Kane meets with Baltar and Sharon. Not that she'll talk to the Cylon or do anything other than just stare in hatred at her.
Yeah.
You can tell from the look on Sharon's face that she knows she's in trouble.
Mm.
The Admiral doesn't take well to Baltar staring off into space when he's speaking to Six, giving him quite the look as well, something that Forbes specialises in. He vaguely salutes her when she leaves, which is quite amusing. Yeah. The Galactica crew start getting prezzies, though, from Kane. Yeah. New supplies. The Gator has the cheek to ask if it includes any porn.
I like that, though.
Which apparently was an ad-lib by Alessandro Giuliani.
Yeah.
Bless him. The rest of the fleet, though, is getting nothing, and Kane isn't even responding to Rosalind's calls. We meet Laird. Not that I think he's named at any point, but what a name, Laird. The deck chief from the Pegasus.
I liked him.
Yeah. Turns out he was a civilian that got rescued and drafted, and you get the impression he got no choice about this.
No, I think she doesn't have any civilians because they've all been bloody conscripted.
Yeah.
And then she shot half of them anyway.
Yep. Then we meet Lieutenant Thorne, who seems to be sort of head of security and is clearly a very, very nasty piece of work.
Oh, yeah.
He's played by Fulvio Cesari, who apparently is a really nice bloke in real life, but can act really well.
Yeah, act really nasty. He does
the most amazing arrogant walk, doesn't he? The way he struts down the corridors.
You know what he reminded me of? I can't remember the actor's name, although I know he's bloody famous. Whoever it was who played Beria in the Stalin one.
Oh, yes, Stefan Starling. Yes, there's that level of arrogance.
Arrogance, and you just know he's horrible and abusive bastard, and it's a really good portrayal. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's definitely the same vibes I was getting.
Well, Cesare was Agent Forbes in Watchmen, the CIA dude who's in charge of Dr. Manhattan. He was also a mobster and middleman in Stargate SG-1 and The X-Files. Then we see the Pegasus silent prisoner. It was a very battered and bound Six, who, according to the commentary, is known as Gina. But again, we'd never get a name here because she doesn't talk. Adama meets Kane in her office, or maybe her ready room. Whee! It's chairless, rather like Captain Lorca's, and has doors that use the same sound effect as the Enterprise holodeck. Did you notice?
No, I didn't.
The Admiral describes how they're being followed by a fleet that includes two base stars and another mystery ship that the Cylons are protecting.
Ooh. I think, I'm not going to say anything, but I think I remember what that ship
we
is.
We find out about it in the next two episodes.
Really? Is it the next? Okay.
Adama is keen on her idea of an attack, but is rather less pleased when she reveals she's combining their crews and reassigning Apollo to the Peggy air crew.
Which, to be fair, I mean, that's... She says, you know, he's been insubordinate and all the rest of it. He has. And actually, if that were me, I would not have father and son on the same crew.
Even if
I didn't necessarily reassign everyone that she reassigns. Yeah. That would be my first reassignment.
Yeah. She also reassigns Kara, who, let's face it, has had a bit of a track record of being disobedient.
Yeah.
Halo hasn't impressed her for impregnating the enemy. And neither is Ty, funnily enough.
Yeah. I think the only one I'd argue about in that actually is Hilo, necessarily.
Mm, yes.
Because you should know that Cylons could be... Even though she's coming at it very much from an anti-Cylon perspective, she should know they're manipulative. So that's the one that I'm less certain of. But the other three, fucking justified.
Mm, yep. But then things really start going to frack with Starbuck off the recon mission, thanks to insubordination. Saying the plan sucks.
Yeah. So I mean, she might not necessarily be wrong, but there's ways and means of saying
exactly.
that.
Exactly. So he steals off with the Blackbird. And Apollo is relegated to being a Raptor pilot. The Peggy Deck crew make charming suggestions about what they can do to Boomer.
Oh, that's horrible.
Yeah. Thorn goes to visit her, as do Tyrol and Halo when they realise what's going to happen.
Mm.
Killing Thorn in the process.
Oh, I can't say I'm sorry.
No, I don't think anybody shed any tears about that whatsoever. Understandably, there were huge disputes with the network about how much we get to see of this, and in the 45-minute cut, we see considerably less. It's a disturbing scene. I mean, it needs to be a disturbing scene.
But
it's
even
a disturbing
so, it's
event.
Still really horrible.
Yeah. I mean, they don't show anything too direct, but...
But you still... It's still really
horrible.
You
can work out what's going on quite easily, can't you?
You can, but again, I know some people are bastards, but is it really necessary to be fucking showing it all the time? Just because these things are written by men? I mean,
interestingly,
you know,
this episode was written by a woman.
But, like, when you see Gina, you know she's been abused, okay? But you don't see any of it.
Yeah.
Why do we have to see it? That's what gets me. Why? And why... I mean, I know the guy...
Well,
is
the argument on the commentary from Ron Moore is that if these horrible things are happening, you've got to let people know they're happening, basically, because otherwise you're glossing over it. But, yeah, the argument about... And whilst it was written by a woman, it was directed by a man, and actually he went rather further than the script originally suggested. So if you've got an issue, you've got an issue not with the writer,
but
with the director.
Fair enough. It's too much, and it isn't necessary. And you just don't need it. It's enough to have all that atmosphere in the room and for Hilo and Tyrol to work out what's happening and for her to be screaming. You don't need any more than that.
Mm-hmm. Then Tyrol and Halo are off to the Pegasus to face trial. In the cell with Gina, Boltar confesses his love for his version of Six. So you better hope the cell isn't being monitored, because he's in all sorts of trouble
that.
Now.
No, I was thinking that.
And there's more weird music, this time kind of Western style. Very odd. It's a very powerful performance from James Callis, though.
Yeah.
So, you know, more credit to him. Ty reports that Halo and Tyrol are going to be executed, and Adama launches the Marines.
I love that.
I'm getting my men, he says. Barks down the phone to her. It's fantastic. And the music at this point is really, really good.
Yeah.
Cue lots of swirling cameras around the Commander and Kane, who...
Oh, made me feel sick.
...who launches her fighters against the Galactica. But actually, I felt that it was justified at this point, because it's that really, you know, sort of really ramping it up for the end of the episode. And it ends with one hell of a cliffhanger, which originally was a break in the season, so people had to wait a month or so before they got the rest of it. In terms of cliffhangers, it's up there with Best of Both Worlds, as far as I'm concerned. So,
Civil War. And we've heard from Doreen, who writes, okay, before I start, and before you tell what you got, remember, is not real, we got a hand-me-down TV, which is much bigger, and it's got HD for Christmas. Ooh. So everything seems so much more real on it.
Yeah.
I didn't like the rape scene, even though we didn't see too much in the interrogation. No, me neither. Might just be me, but just being told about it would have been enough. Absolutely. I completely agree. I know it drove the story forward, but I don't know if the audience needed to see the actress's buttocks. No, we didn't. Anthony had to explain to me why the Admiral on the single ship work on Radama and the group of ships to the fleet rather than the other way round. It's just chain of command, isn't
it? Yeah,
yep. I felt a bit like the writers were not crediting me, i.e. the audience, with enough intelligence in some parts of this. Whilst on the one hand we're all supposed to know that a higher ranking officer on one ship could just constitute an entire fleet. It did seem the bits that they explained, some of them seemed weird compared to the bits that they didn't.
All right.
I think I'd agree with that.
Mm.
Thank you, Doreen.
Sampo and Yana have this to say. This is one of the more memorable episodes of the series, introducing the sleek and sexy Battlestar Pegasus. Sleek and sexy? It's a lump! Along with her captain, the highly psychotic Admiral Kane. Quite a biblical name, but then who is Abel? Adama? Or the poor exo she apparently shot? Well, again, this is just carrying over from the original Battlestar Galactica. Although to start with, everyone is all smiles, and why wouldn't they be? The firepower of the fleet just more than doubled, and the amount of alive humans just jumped up significantly.
Exactly, it makes sense.
But from the moment the new colonials step out of the Raptor, Yana noted from their body language alone that this is a very different crew compared to the Galactica crew.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. So while Kane initially appears to be harsh but fair, her true nature starts to show pretty quickly. While I would have maybe preferred a slow burn over several episodes, at least things don't get boring. Of all the criticisms of this episode, boring is not going to be one of them, is it? Although Kane initially promises not to get involved with the inner runnings of the Galactica, she only needs to read through the Galactica's logs once, and she decides things have to change. To be fair, she's not completely wrong.
No, she's not.
It only takes Starbuck about 30 seconds on board the Pegasus to get into trouble. We appreciated the fact that the logs are all written on paper. So remember, a few episodes ago, when Yana had the idea to keep captured Cylons alive, but in a bad state, well, it appears that she and Kane have similar ideas. Should I be scared? Yes, basically. In any case, seeing the tortured six aboard the Pegasus is really quite nasty.
Yeah.
But when Rapey McGee, goes over to the Galactica to try the same shit with Sharon, Halo and Tyrell suddenly find that they have a lot in common.
Yeah.
The episode ends in a standoff between the two Battlestars after Halo and Tyrell are sentenced to death in the quickest trial of all time. Whilst complimenting Galactica on its continuity is like saying that the sky is blue, I do appreciate the callback to the time that Adama disbanded the civilian court. Yeah, again, she has a point all the way through this.
Yeah,
it's like, you don't like her, but a lot of what she says is actually true.
Yeah.
This episode paints two very different paths that could have happened to a Battlestar crew after the initial battle. Adama has had the civilian fleet and Roslyn keeping him in check, and I have to believe he has somewhat stronger morals than Kane. Here's hoping. But it's not black and white, and the Pegasus crew is not all evil. The assholes seem to be in commanding roles, which most likely is not a coincidence. Making the tough calls can harden people, and I could see Kane appointing such people to keep the people below them in line. Adama has also softened a bit since the beginning of the series, and I can only assume that the reverse has happened to Kane. If the two had met earlier, things might have gone a lot differently.
Yeah.
Thinking all the way back to the miniseries brings another alternative take on history. If Roslyn had not convinced Adama to stop fighting, the Galactica crew may look a lot like the Pegasus crew looks now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, Yana commented that the crew of the Pegasus is close to what she expected the Galactica crew to be after the miniseries, instead of a bunch of hippies that we got. Call them hippies, but okay.
Yeah.
So yes, this is an all in all a classic episode and one of the better ones of the whole series. I'm assuming that Yana also liked the episode, since when the end credits appeared on screen, she said something to the effect of, "What? No?" And now we have to wait a month for the next episode. Damn you, Picard! Yeah, he's to blame. Yeah, well, as I say, quite realistic as well, because I think that was at least a month before people got new episodes.
I can remember...
back when it was broadcast.
Well, I seem to remember that you could get the first half of the season on DVD or something and not the second half, and they did it in two releases as well, so that you didn't know necessarily what was happening. It was a nightmare. And we've heard from Jeff, who writes, "This episode was almost too intense for me. Mm. Even in the beginning, when it seems like a happy miracle has appeared, Commander Adama seems to be exuding a sense of dread. So much of the early interactions with Admiral Kane seems to be more about what is not said rather than the actual conversation. More excellent work from Mr. Olmos, and Michelle Forbes is more than equal to the task."
She is fantastic, actually. We haven't mentioned but she's really, really good.
"Even when smiling and pleasant, she's terrifying." Yes, she is. "James Callis is also a standout in this episode, and less being played for laughs this time. I actually found his interactions with the horribly treated six genuine and touching. Mm-hmm. Though I have to imagine that there are cameras set up in that cell, so I really wonder what the Pegasus crew make of him talking to the air in the earlier episode. Also great was Ty getting buddy-buddy with his Pegasus counterpart. Michael Hogan's reactions in the drinking scene were brilliant." Yeah, they were.
Mm-hmm.
"The only real issue for me was how blatantly evil the Pegasus crew turned out to be so early. The interrogation of Sharon was horrendous and it made me sick to my stomach. I guess it's good that a brutal act was portrayed in a brutal way, but I question if it's appropriate storytelling or mere exploitation." Yeah, I think it went over the line myself. "All in all, exceptionally compelling television. I'm a little hazy on how this storyline resolves, so I'm eager to see the rest regardless. Thanks again for all you do. Until next time." Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. We've heard from Andrew.
"It's a good news, bad news day for the ragtag fleet. Good news, there's another Battlestar. Bad news, it's this Battlestar. With this crew. And this commander. Oh boy." So this is very much a tale of two spaceships. You have the basically museum ship, Battlestar Galactica. And you have the fully armed and operational Battlestar Pegasus. Pegasus is very hardcore. And its crew is very hardcore as well. You can see that in the Pegasus CAG. You can see that in the difference in Colonel Fisk between when he's on Pegasus and when he's on Galactica. You can see that in Admiral Kane, certainly. Very much so. And you can see this in the treatment of Cylon prisoners. In particular, female Cylon prisoners. And I think a lot of what leads to the difference in the cultures between Galactica and Pegasus is a lot to do with the commanders. There's a very big difference in command style and personality between Adama and Kane. But also I think there's the manner of their entry into the Cylon conflict. Galactica was far away when the colonies fell. Galactica was safe. Galactica heard about it on the radio. But Pegasus was there. Pegasus was right there when the colonies fell. Pegasus was right there when the shipyards were attacked. Pegasus was there when ships around it were destroyed. Pegasus crew got out with their lives, and not all of them. You know, a third of the crew died. For Pegasus, the Cylon attack is very much nearer, very much more personal than for Galactica. And so, is it any surprise that when they find a Cylon in their midst, that they can take their revenge on? And when you combine that feeling with a commanding officer who shot her own first officer because he wouldn't follow her orders in front of a whole CIC full of people, is it any surprise that it's as awful as it is? Serial, prolonged beating, I'm assuming starvation, and repeated rape, to the point where this poor six literally just shuts down and they go to Galactica to do exactly the same to Sharon as well. And it's in this kind of weird area where I think if you asked them, these frat boy pilots who've been bragging and joking about what they've been doing in the brig, if they considered what they'd been doing to be rape, you'd probably get a yes and a no. I mean, you'd get a no in as much as they'd probably say, it's a robot, how can you rape a robot? But then they brag about it and they joke about it as if it is. And there's no point in doing it if it's not. I mean, this is calculated, considered torture. There's no point doing it. There's no point in them raping the six if it doesn't inflict the kind of physical, psychological, and emotional damage that we know that rape does. And I'm sure that's what they'd say ultimately, and what Lieutenant Thorne would say ultimately. Yes, it is what it is, but she's a Cylon, and the Cylons destroyed humanity, so she deserves it. And I think there are parallels to be drawn with the farms back on Caprica. With the farms, I think the Cylons are basically indifferent to the suffering of women, whereas on Pegasus, the suffering is very much intentional, but there is certainly a theme common to both humans and Cylons of using female bodies for their own purposes, without the care, consideration, or consent of the women involved, be they human women or Cylon women. All of which is a very long way of saying, maybe Pegasus isn't the lucky ship, maybe Galactica's the lucky ship. Maybe Galactica, with a ragtag fleet to look after and set an example for, with a president to act as a moderating influence, with a different crew, with a different commander, with a different temperament, which came into the Cylon conflict under different circumstances, maybe they're the lucky ship. Because on Pegasus, the day that the attack on the colonies happened, there was a wound inflicted on that ship, and that wound has festered ever since. And that festering has created a poison which has spread throughout the ship in the form of a culture which endorses and gives sanction to the kind of atrocities that have been inflicted on the Six and Sharon and the summary execution of their first officer. And that's not even mentioning the planned execution of Tyrell and Hilo, which is our cliffhanger into next week. Next week? Next podcast. Which also gives us one of BSG's signature pieces of music, Prelude to War, which is kind of Battlestar Galactica's answer to Duel of the Fates. It's BSG's Stuff's Gonna Happen music. I'd recommend actually going to YouTube and watching Bear McCreary play this on the piano. It's 6 or 7 minutes of him just making you incredibly envious that a person can do that kind of thing. And with that, time's up. Take care of yourselves, and bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.
I do think you're right that it's different ships faced by different circumstances, and Roslyn and having the civilian fleet has been a moderating force.
Mm.
Because we do know that... I'm thinking in particular the liberating armies in World War Two. I mean, they didn't see the other people as human, and there was a hell of a lot of rape. And it's female bodies are used as the tool of war.
Hmm.
I'd rather not see it the way it was seen, but it is a fact.
Mm. Yeah, I don't think anybody's arguing that it shouldn't have been suggested that was happening.
Yeah.
But I think that the interesting argument is whether we should have seen as much as we did.
That's my contention. Yeah.
I also like the really good moment in that scene where, as he put it, the frat boys and Pegasus were boasting about what they'd been doing, and all the female deck crew leave in disgust. And it's like, yeah. But that piece of music is really, really good, and I can see why you'd equate it with Duel of the Fates, because, yes, I hope we do get to hear that again, because that's fantastic stuff.
Well, presumably we get to hear it next time, even if it's just in the recap.
Quite possibly, yes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
What did the Llama God make of this?
Nothing in between, something blue.
Alright then, now where were we? Yes, the Pegasus. Now this is a very interesting episode, isn't it? I mean, it's a brilliant episode, but it's also strange, because this is one of the few times when you compare it with the original Galactica episode that obviously it was inspired by, it, and you think, maybe, would prefer some of the lightheartedness from that original episode. I mean, yeah, it's good that we don't have the lecherousness of old man Lloyd Bridges in this one, and we have a very different take on Admiral Kane instead, but still, this gets dark pretty quickly, doesn't it? But then this is Galactica, what are you going to expect? So yes, there's a nice interesting start to the episode with Kara trying to hatch a plan to rescue Sam, and the revelation that they have actually lost Caprica somehow. Have they really done that many jumps? I mean, I guess we know the first episode of the first series in 33 that they've done hundreds of jumps, so yeah, maybe they are that far away and that confused from Caprica. But yeah, Starbuck was able to jump back there quite quickly in this final fight. Why is that an issue? But this becomes a non-issue very, very quickly when the Pegasus appears. Hurrah! I mean, obviously they play up the tension a little bit, but given the episode is called Pegasus, it's not much of a surprise when she does arrive. And isn't she a gorgeous ship? The whole scene when they first meet each other is absolutely gorgeous. The ship itself looks lovely. And the music, I mean, this is some of Bear McCreary's best work in this track. I absolutely adore this track. It's a beautiful piece of music. Yeah, no, it's a wonderful moment. And it stays wonderful and nice since the fleet being reunited for all of about 5 minutes and when Kane comes aboard and takes command. Now, again, there's some degree of professionalism here that Adama shows. I mean, it's mostly just Adama. And you've got to draw parallels with the Chain of Command episode of Star Trek Next Generation, where once a new commander comes in, all of the senior officers and the rest of the crew have a bit of a fit about having to take somebody else's orders. Like, come on, guys, you're professionals. You should be used to this. I mean, I guess you could excuse Roslyn for being a little bit put out by realising that Fleet's going to be under someone else's command now, because she's worked very hard to get the rapport that she has with Adama, and, you know, they've just gone through a difficult time and they've actually just built up a really good relationship, and now that's being taken away. And also, despite how well she's managing so far as, you know, role as president, she still hasn't really had that much experience. So that's bound to have been a bit of a shock to her. And I guess you can't be surprised to see that Lee and Kara don't really take things, their reassignments, too well, because, you know, they're just assholes as it is. So it's nice to see that Adama himself is the one who's gracious enough to accept that the chain of command has changed with the arrival of an admiral. So, yeah. But of course, you find out soon enough that things aren't as they seem, and obviously where the two crews have gone down very different paths. And it is very interesting, because obviously what Kane's been doing is exactly what Adama himself wanted to do at the end of the first miniseries. But instead, he listened to Roslyn and decided to protect the fleet rather than go on the offensive. Kane, on the other hand, has been on the offensive, and so this is what they could have become. This is who they could have become, and what they've become is very cruel. You say that they're cruel. I mean, we have had incidents in the Galactica of Cylons being spaced. They have developed a degree of mercilessness themselves. But if anything, then spacing a Cylon is in a way merciful, because it's a quick death, isn't it? Whereas the treatment that the sixth model has endured at the hand of the Pegasus crew is horrific. And I know this is meant to be horrifying. I know it's meant to disturb us and show just how bad they are. And the attempted rape of Sharon is also just to show us just how bad the Pegasus crew are and how lost they are. But it really is a bit problematic, because rape, as a shorthand for saying these people are bad, is something that's been really overdone, and it's a very lazy trope. I don't know, because obviously this show was made 15 years ago now, and we hadn't lived through 8 seasons of Game of Thrones going, hey, these people are bad guys because they rape people, and rape makes them bad guys. And also, women grow through rape. All those sorts of really shitty messages that they put out. So we hadn't had been through that. So maybe this wasn't so bad at the time. I don't know. I mean, I've got to admit, this isn't something that I was particularly paying attention to at the time, and it's hearing voices and stories about it now, especially post-Me Too, you realise how prevalent these things are. So maybe this would have played better years ago. Maybe it wouldn't have been such a thing. But it's still very uncomfortable that this is the device they're using to show just how bad the Pegasus crew actually are. And whilst it's nice that the chief interrogator gets his comeuppance, even if it's accidental, it's still, I think, maybe a little bit too far. Yeah, it's a bit too grim, too much for the sake of it, I'd say, and this is the only blight on this episode. But that incident does come to a head with the chief and Hilo being being charged and found guilty and facing execution, which causes Adama to finally snap and do what he thinks to be the right thing. This is interesting, because we've only just had one mutiny and now we're having another one that Adama's leading. So yeah, this is very interesting and very frustrating, because we leave it with to be continued, and then we don't find out for another month thanks to Picard. Damn it. But yeah, no, I can understand that you need to space these things out for your own sanities. So yeah, in all, I'd say that this is a good episode, but definitely marred by the storytelling tropes that are used to convey certain ideas. So in terms of the watches, I think I'll skip pregnancy watch this week, because yeah, let's leave that one for now. And plan watch, yeah, we haven't really seen much from the Cylons since we saw them watching the documentary at the end of Final Cut, so still no more insights as to what's going on there. So I look forward to hearing what everyone else thinks about all of this, and I look forward to feeding back to you on this in a month's time. And here's hoping that having to do all these podcasts at the same time doesn't drive you too water. And I'd imagine, so say we all. And when I say all, I mean, you know, your listeners and feedback is not the weird sexy silence in your heads.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're not quite that mad yet. But give us time.
I thought that as well with Kara, and it's like, oh, 241 jumps. I was thinking at the time, but you did it. So what has changed?
Yeah. Okay. Because she was, what was she using? The Cylon Raider, wasn't she?
Yeah.
But why that should be any different, I don't know.
Because time I went, how did she get back so quick? And you were all like, kaboom, ba-boom.
Yeah, it's an instant. Yes.
But then your kaboom, ba-bloom, technobabble.
Apparently doesn't work anymore.
Yeah. You broke it.
Be broken. Yes. But yes, it is very, very different to the original series one. But wasn't Jeff Bridges' character in love with some woman that was far, far younger than him?
Yes.
It was really creepy, wasn't it?
Yeah, and then she ended up, didn't she end up part of the crew?
Was that his daughter?
Oh, I can't remember. Maybe he was in love with his daughter. It was all very
wrong. Yeah. Anyway, we're not going to rewatch that anytime soon. But yes, I think there's a sort of growing consensus. This is possibly over the line slightly, yeah. I think.
Over the line!
Yeah, quite. Anyways, let's find out what Drew and Tracy made of it.
Hello, this is our feedback for Pegasus.
And what did we think of that one then?
Well, it's exciting stuff.
That was a really stressful episode.
Yeah, stressful as hell.
Let me tell you. So let's start from the beginning.
Yes.
So great news to hear that Pegasus have come out of nowhere.
Before the titles, it was all up, you know, lovely music. Yep. And oh, yeah, we're all celebrating.
Yeah, the Pegasus.
I knew it wasn't going to last.
they? But they didn't exactly look fucking friendly when they got off their little shuttle, did they?
That was the first clue, wasn't it?
That was a bit wrong. Poor Adama. It must have been a kick in the gugglies to kind of have to kind of take a step back, considering he has led the fleet for such a long time and he's kind of been in command, and now all of a sudden Kane turns up and she outranks him and he's got to take a step back.
It is, but I do also agree with what Roslyn said, and that is he must also feel relief. Oh, I'm no longer in control of everything now. I'm just following orders. You know, it is good to be able to go, okay, you're the boss. Yeah. I'll do what you say.
Not if, like, your boss is a twat.
Yes, that's a good point.
So, oh my God, Prisoner 6.
Yes.
That was really harsh.
I know.
That was just awful, really, really hard viewing. You know, I mean, yes, all right, mm-hmm. She's a Cylon, but Christ almighty, no
yeah,
one.
Yeah, but there's like the Geneva Convention. There's like ways of treating
absolutely.
Prisoners and stuff,
I mean,
stuff,
that's just
isn't there?
Abominable. And then when they went into
Sharon,
and then they started beating her up, and then, you know, oh, no. I mean, yeah, Chief, you shouldn't have, like, or basically nutted him because he got a nut in the head, didn't
he?
Well,
he didn't deliberately
It wasn't
try
deliberate,
and kill him,
no.
But, you know, on the other hand, he probably would have killed him if he had the opportunity. But, yeah, it was unfortunate.
Just desserts and all that. Little bastard.
I like in this how, you know, they're obviously set up, like the people from the Pegasus, to be real horrible people.
Yeah.
And now, look at Bolter. Bolter's a goodie all of a sudden, isn't he? You know, before, he was a baddie, and all of a sudden, one episode, and he's like, we're all on his side, and, you know, he's now in a positive light.
Because Bolter's going to save 6.
Well, hopefully.
Hopefully.
You know, it's good. I love this kind of stuff, just turning the character completely on its head.
Yeah, but what I'm going to say is, like, although Adama has kind of handed over command, and Kane is a bitch, two ways about that, but she has got valid points in the fact that she has let, you know, Adama has let
things
people
slide.
Get away with, like, shit for such a long time.
Yes.
I mean, for all intents and purposes, this is a military function, and there is no fucking way that Starbuck would talk to a superior officer the way that she does and get away with it. She would have been hung, drawn and quartered, because it's just so fucking disrespectful.
Yes.
And this is the real problem that I have with Starbuck. She's so fucking rude.
She is, yes. And I agree with you. And also, it shows that even Apollo, like, after she'd been taken off the mission, and he's going, oh yeah, I'll take this camera and go on a sneaky mission. It's not how the military should behave.
No, exactly. Well, not when your dad's in command, you know. You're getting away with a lot of shit there. So, badass Adama.
Yes. At the end, yes.
Fucking
when
it
was that bit when Ty was telling him what's going on, they're going to be executed, and he just like pulls from it and he grimaced in his face. And at that point, he was like, that's it, you've crossed the line.
But when Kane gave him orders to transfer Starbuck and Apollo,
and he didn't like that
face
then.
Was just like, I kill you.
I know, but he hadn't been pushed past the line, but it was that bit when he was on the telephone and he just like,
and this
he was
reinforces
that was it.
My love for Adama, because he clearly said to the president, you know, oh, I've been taking orders my whole life. This is absolutely no different. You know, I'm not opposed to taking orders, but he knows right from wrong, and she fucking done wrong. So he's gone in there to kick her fucking ass and
well, hopefully, we'll see in the next episode.
Well, exactly. I just feel very stressed now.
Yes.
We need the next one. Anyway.
Yes. Yeah, this is great.
I really loved
this
it.
This is real tension and good stuff.
Loved it.
Yeah.
Ty and the
other XO.
They were really funny. They did make me chuckle.
Yeah.
They're so funny. Anyway, can't wait for the next one.
No, I'm really looking forward to the next one as well.
Shall we leave it there?
Definitely.
Take it easy. See you later. Bye.
Bye. Maybe it's just as well I'm doing one a month, considering how stressful this is proving for everybody.
Yeah, you're right. It's good the way that each episode can turn the table. Sometimes Bolter is a goodie and sometimes he's a baddie. And he's,
it
you
depends
know,
on context.
Yeah, it does, which I like. But yeah, I mean, Starbuck is so insubordinate. She should not have been getting away with that on Galactica.
Yeah, and she only is because she's Adama's favourite.
And it is wrong. They are in the military.
Mm.
And, you know, some of it you can understand that Adama's been giving them a little bit of slack, because ordinarily in the military there would be time off, you'd be on rotation, you get shore leave. Do you know what I mean? So I get that it's going to be a little bit slacker, but that's just too much.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. What did Parry make of this?
Hello again. Parry here to talk about Pegasus. I do remember when this series came out and the season was announced, and they said, oh yeah, they are going to be doing the Return of the Legend, I think it was, story from the original, but they've got a bit of a different take on it, so we were going to see the Battlestar Pegasus. And indeed, from the beginning, we can see they've got a different take on it, because the Pegasus is not the Galactica with a different name stenciled onto it. No, she is a beast. A massive, big Battlestar, a more advanced one, and they really play up how, they really manage to accentuate how much more advanced she is, with the lovely glass panels in their CNC, the fancier looking phones, everything looks clean and shiny, and you actually have Baltar saying, lovely ship, very new. And yeah, there is that, but of course, we have the initial celebration of, hey, we found another battle, so, it's not just we found, in theory, finding anyone's good news. But in this particular situation, we've not just found anyone, we've found another Battlestar, a better Battlestar, a big fancy Battlestar. So, that's even better. And indeed, everything seems cordial at the start. Of course, we have Admiral Kane, this time not played by Lloyd Bridges, but played by Ro Laren. Ensign Ro, she's done all right for herself, hasn't she? Promotion to Admiral and command of a big ship in a different fleet and different universe. All she had to do was hide her nose ridges. Amazing stuff. And playing a different character, and indeed, to an extent, you do see a hint of the respective commanders, I mean commander in the job rather than the rank thing, and their respective battle star. Kane is all sharp edges, she's slim, she's younger, and she's definitely got a more driven angle to her. Whereas on the other hand, you have Adama, who's a bit more worn, fatherly, like his Battlestar. So I did like that. They really made them a good comparison. And of course, it's not long before we find out something isn't right. So she might have executed her first officer, and we later on find out when they see their Cylon prisoner, who's none other than another Six. And I thought actually a really nice touch this was the acting from Callis here. James Callis actually has a blinder in this episode, and he's not being used for just comedy. He's actually been given some really serious stuff to do, not just stand around looking bemused. And so there is things like the minute they walk into the cell, they both he covers his face, so we can't smell how bad that cell smells. And indeed, it doesn't look particularly bad smelling, because it's just they've not let her wash and she's got open sores and that sort of thing. And but it's more, but the actors play it well, and indeed also Six's reaction to seeing it, they build that up really well. And of course, yes, it turns out that their lieutenant, I'm not going to remember his name or give him his name, because frankly, their interrogator lieutenant's a dick. I'm glad he got a bolt through his head. I'm glad we only saw him for a few minutes, because they're a rapey bastard. And frankly, the more rapey bastards who die by having their head smashed off a bolt, the better the universe is. And again, really good writing that they engender that much emotion for me in a character who's in, three scenes, and one of them is a corpse. But that's enough to we get this slow trickle of build up of, the different, initially it's just differences, they keep kill markings, well that's a bit weird, and then we start getting Kane putting her foot down, where there's hints that she's not talking to Rosalind, and it all culminates with one hell of a cliffhanger. There is a lovely scene, actually another part with Callis, when he's talking about his interrogation techniques, and she's kind of, well, you've not got me anything new, and he does his thing of, look, she's sort of accusing him of getting too close, and he says, look, quite frankly, I wish they were all, they're better exterminated, and the universe would be better off without them, kind of thing. He sort of looks over the Exo's shoulder just briefly, and I like the idea that was actually him looking at his head Six, almost for approval, but for once we didn't see her. I just thought it was a nice tick from the actor. Don't know if it was deliberate, but if it was, very well done. And yeah, we do, I mean, the way this thing builds up and spirals, and indeed, again, almost as an absolute powerhouse, the way he kind of goes from, no, this is how it works, and we're fine, to absolute, and, when he finds out the trial's over, his absolute fury. He does not like legal unfairness, does our Adama. And that scene where it suddenly starts, it ramps up so quickly, and the music obviously backing it really helps, and so yeah, it really leads us to to be honest, I get this episode recorded. I shouldn't say get this episode recorded. You do you. But I'm really, really going to struggle holding out to watch the next episode. But I will. So until that time, all it remains to say is do keep up the good work. I always look forward to the podcast. And I should... Well, it's really unlikely. Something bad will have to happen for me not to feedback to the next one. Because, to be honest, I'm on tenterhooks here. And I had to wait a week for this to happen last time. So yeah, really looking forward to the next episode. So until then, bye for now.
Bye. It's not difficult for us to hold off watching the next one because we just don't have the time.
We would need a time machine.
Yeah, oh boy.
Yeah. And you're right, I hadn't thought of it before, but it's legal unfairness that pushes Adama's buttons. That's why he stops the witch hunt.
Yes.
And that's why he takes action here.
And his father was a lawyer, wasn't
he? Yeah.
So there's, yes. And I think it is fair to say that Eddie almost looks slightly more worn than Michelle Forbes.
just a
tiny bit.
Seriously, though, what's the age difference between them? Because...
Ooh, a few decades.
Well, the reason I mention it is that Eddie almost is one of those people that I'm always a little bit surprised isn't dead.
He has looked ancient for a while.
Do you know what I mean?
But at this stage, he's looking so ancient. Blimey.
Yeah. Whereas Michelle Forbes, I thought, was around our age.
Yeah. Anyways, thank you to everybody who's fed back. Next time, in terms of Borgcast Galactica, we shall be recording on Friday the 6th of March. So plenty of time to consume Resurrection Ship Parts 1 and 2,
ooh,
which very much continues the story. But yes, the reason why we're at the moment monthly, of course, is because of the Picard Borgcast podcast. And which we're doing weekly because that's when it's being released.
Yeah.
And we're up to the third episode of that, which will be coming out as we're recording tomorrow. So this will actually probably, it'll all come out on the same day,
time. But we're generally recording that on Saturdays.
Yes, I think that's what we've kind of settled with now. I think it makes more sense.
Occasionally, if we've got something on the Saturday, we'll have to record on a Friday. Mm. But in the main, that'll be on Saturdays. And then we'll have a little bit of a tiny breather and then Discovery.
Yeah. And well, if you're not particularly a Trek fan, well worth checking out Picard if you've got access to Amazon Prime, because, in this country anyway, because it is rather different, I'm finding, and rather jolly good, actually. I'm getting into it now, so there we are.
It's good fun. Recommend.
Yeah. Right. If not, we'll catch you on the next Galactica in a month's time. So say we orcs.
So say we orcs. D&D. The music at the beginning of this podcast was arranged and performed by Drew Barker.
All other music is used for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
The artwork for Borgcast Galactica was created by Andy Pelastides.
To contact us, send emails or mp3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
Contact us via Twitter at rev_org or borgcastammo, hashtag borgcast.
Visit our website at galactica.libsyn.com.
Or view images relating to our cast on our Tumblr site, borgcast.tumblr.com.
And there's also a Spotify playlist with all our playout tunes on it. Sign on the door, D&D. Don't disturb us no more. I'd like you to make your love my hideaway, and I'd like you to make my troubles slide away.
Shut it down! By your command.